God will direct you. The Bible says, be ye not unwise, but understanding. Understand what the will of the Lord is. If we will seek Him, God will show us how to be blessed. God will break off of us whatever the devil has put on us in Jesus' name. Ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. There's power in us to bring healing and miracles and signs and wonders in the name of Jesus. Nothing shall be impossible to us. Nothing shall be withheld from us because we are walking uprightly before the Lord. I break generational curses. I break it in the name of Jesus Christ. May there be a change that takes place for the glory of the Lord. In Jesus' name. Today, I want all of our pastors and our deacons, I want you to come. I want those who are in leadership in our church, I want you to come also. I want even our ushers to come down here to the front. If you hold any kind of office in our church, I want you to come. I have been so deeply grieved because of the things that have happened this past week. The decisions made by the White House, by our president, by the Supreme Court justices. I feel like it is one of the great sins, and it's opened the door for terrible things to come upon our nation. And I don't know what the laws are going to come forth and how they will affect our church or how they will affect me as a pastor upon embracing homosexuality and performing marriages, but we will not participate in that. And I want to say that in no way do you hear me ever throwing rocks at those that are in adultery, those that are in alcoholism, those that are in drug addiction, nor those abound by homosexuality. We want to minister to everyone. When I was a little boy, I joined the YMCA. I was 8 years old when I joined the Y. You could join it for $8. And I used to ride the bus down there. My dad would always talk to me. He said, now, Bob, there are people who would try to abuse you. And over the years, you have situations where homosexuals would come, and it would scare me. And I would see them coming, and I would go the other way. When I was just a boy, a homosexual broke into our home. And I was upstairs, and I remember this man came into my bedroom. And I began to scream, and my dad heard me. My dad woke up, and I can hear him running up the steps now, just as I did then. It was so real. And this man turned and fled. He ran down the hall, went through the bathroom, and there was a window. He got out on a porch, and he jumped off down and fled. But from that point on, I had a real dislike for homosexuals and how they would try to come against and abuse people. And then God called me to preach. And I'm a single pastor now. And a fellow comes to our church and he said, Pastor, I want you to pray for me. He said, I am a homosexual. And I thought to myself, I said, how can I minister to him when I don't like to be around homosexuals and I don't like homosexuals? So I asked God to begin to do a work in my life, to heal my life. And God really did. God gave me a compassion on those that are bound by that sin. And that man was delivered. When I say he was delivered, God absolutely delivered that man from homosexuality. And over the years, we have stood against that sin and other sins. And we have seen literally scores and scores, probably over 100 homosexuals that have been totally delivered. I've encouraged them to fast for 21 days. And in the Bible, that was one of the ways to break homosexuality in the book of Judges. And I've never encouraged any of these to give their testimony because I felt like people would not accept them because of that sin. But now, this terrible abomination, and that's what it is, it's an abomination, has been released on our country. And I'm asking that this Thursday that you would join with me. I've asked our whole church body and our extension churches and 38 services if they would take Thursday as a time of fasting, at least fast until the evening meal. We're going to have a great service here, a service of repentance for our nation. And I'm asking you to pray for the repentance of our land. Now this morning, here's what I'm asking our leadership to do. I'm asking you to kneel down. If you can't kneel, go sit down. But I'm asking you to kneel down as a sign of humbling ourselves for repentance, as a sign unto God that, Lord, don't bring this judgment on us. We're not for this. This was not done with our approval. I'm going to ask Margaret to lead us in this prayer of repentance. And if you feel that you should kneel, I want you to kneel. But I want us to humble ourselves against the sins of our nation. You know, one of the things that happened to Sodom was one of the well-watered cities of the plains. There are pastors and churches that will embrace this. And Sodom turned into a desert, and their churches will turn to deserts if they embrace the sin. And our country is turning into a desert in arid places. Now, four states have declared droughts, severe droughts. California, it's the worst drought in the history of California. And it's a sign already beginning to take place. Margaret?
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, today we humble ourselves before you. Lord, your word says to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. Lord, our nation has not humbled herself. Our White House, our leaders, our Congress, our Supreme Court, the high areas of our land have exalted themselves above the very Almighty God. Oh God, we repent today. We repent today for a nation that has embraced sin, that has embraced the very abominations that you have taught us and taught us to guard ourselves against. Father, today we repent for the sin of homosexuality. We repent, Lord, that we have allowed ourselves to compromise and to embrace sin, to bring it into our homes, into our hearts, into our families, into our schools, into our places of leadership and law. Oh, Father, forgive us today. Lord, may churches across this nation humble themselves. May Christians fall before you, God, in humility, pleading, God, for your forgiveness. Lord, may there be spring forth from this terrible thing something good, God. May revival come forth. May souls be changed. May lives be transformed. May Christians be renewed and find again their first love in you, Lord. Lord, today we repent, God. We repent, Father, for other sins, God. We repent for the sin of hatred and impurities that have plagued our homes, our lives, our minds, that we've entertained things, God, within our heart and mind that were impure, Father. And Lord, today, may you begin something in this church, in our congregation, Lord, in churches across Louisville, in our city, in southern Indiana, in our schools, in our places of leadership, in the mayor's office, in our courts, in our schools, in our homes, in our neighborhoods. In Jesus' name, bring forgiveness, God. May the grace of Jesus Christ prevail in our lives. And Lord, may you once again visit us, God, with revival and peace upon our land. And today, I felt the Lord gave me this scripture. It's from Matthew 3:10, and it says, "And even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees." And in the name of Jesus, may there be an axe of the mighty hand of God, the God who is able to transform, to destroy the works of the enemy. May the axe be put to the tree of impurity, of compromise, of homosexuality, of things that our nation has embraced. May that be cut to the ground. And Lord, out of that may there spring forth a new root. A root of righteousness, a root of purity, a root of revival. In Jesus' name, let the miracle working power of Christ, God, be seen in the mighty hand of, in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray.
I want us all to stand. I want us to pray this prayer together. So, Lord Jesus, we repent of this sin. We ask in Jesus' name, you would not lay this guilt upon us. May we be as one of those righteous that God said he would not have destroyed the city of Sodom if there were 50 righteous, if there were 40 righteous, if even there were 10 righteous. Lord, in Jesus' name, fill us with love and power in the name of Jesus. We declare we're soul winners. We declare revival is coming. And every person we come in contact with, we're going to love them into the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name. Now, Father, we pray for our families. We draw a circle about them. It's a circle of the power of the Holy Ghost, the fire of God. May none of our family fall into perversion, into sexual sins. But Lord, keep them pure. Keep them godly. In Jesus' name, for the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah to Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lord. Now let me say this. I do not agree that people are born homosexuals. I believe that Jesus, when he said, talked about those who were in homosexuality, they would go to hell. They would have a place in the lake of fire. If they were born that way, God would be totally unfair in saying that. But I do believe that people have tendencies. And there are people who have tendencies to drink. I've known people that took one beer and they became addicted to alcohol because there was a tendency in their DNA. You were born to be that way, well, someone could say, I was born to be an adulterer. And so they would have a get-out-of-jail-free card to commit adultery and fornication with women after women after women and have 20 illegitimate children. You may have tendencies, but you have to rebuke those and you have to come against them and flee them. And there are people that have tendencies for homosexuality, but you have to flee that and ask God's strength and God's power, and God will help you and God will deliver you. But this is a time of increase. God said he was going to increase us and he was going to bless us in Jesus' name. I gave a prophecy to a fellow this week, and that prophecy, I told him, I said, God is going to bring money into your hands before Sunday. And he said, well, you know, Pastor, he said that when you give a word like that, that'll come back to bless you. And I said, well, I received that because I need some money. And so the next day, a fella sent us $20,000 for that station in Israel. Come on, hallelujah. And we've had a lot of situations where we've had to do certain things, and the Palestinians have required money from the government. And now by the end of, as of yesterday, $100,000 came in for that station over in Israel. Hallelujah. We had to have 80,000 of that, and it came in for the glory of God. Come on, give the Lord a great praise clap. Hallelujah. I want you to reach over and touch the person next to you. Say, in Jesus' name, God's going to bless you with money. God's going to prosper you. You're coming into unexpected wealth. Not nickels and dimes, not $10 bills, but hundreds of dollars, thousands of dollars, tens of thousands of dollars. Now, as you're blessing them, guess what? God's going to bless you. Pray one for another that ye may be healed. I bless others with healing, and God heals me. I bless others with blessings of finances. And folks, they'll come right back on you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, this is on television Tuesday, I gave a word of knowledge that God was healing somebody with a knee. There's a knee, your cartilage is loose. Well, we have a fella on our staff, Pastor Joe Washington. And Pastor Joe told me, he said, I'm going to have to take a couple of weeks off because they're going to do surgery on my knee. And I wasn't even thinking about him. And he was getting dressed to go for surgery to check into the hospital. And as he's getting dressed, he had the television on at home. He lives over in Elizabethtown. And I said, there's somebody being healed. So he lays his hands on his knee. He says, Lord, I receive that for myself. So when he got to the hospital, they were prepping him for surgery. And the doctor says, my goodness, he says, your knee has gotten tight here. I don't think we're going to do surgery. And God's healed Joe Washington. I said, well, you're going to take a couple of weeks off for surgery. He said, well, I've gone to Florida. I think I'll just use that to kind of enjoy myself down here, do some little fishing in the name of Jesus. That's a fishy story, and hallelujah. But God is doing miracles in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, let's lift our hands right now to the Lord. Come on, let's lift our hands high. I want us to begin to just praise the Lord right now. Father, we worship you. Father, we hallow your great name. Father, this is a time for miracles. This is a time for great breakthroughs in the name of Jesus Christ. Lay your hand right here on your chest. Say, in Jesus' name, this is miracle time. This is a time of increase. My family shall be increased. Every person I'm around is getting blessed in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah to Jesus. Let's give the Lord a great big praise clap. Hallelujah. I break it in the name of Jesus Christ. May there be a change that takes place for the glory of the Lord. In Jesus' name.
The all-new home for Bob Rogers Ministries is now open. Visit BobRogersMinistries.org to submit prayer requests, see sermons, stay connected, and more, including the all-new Partners Only website, where partners go for even more. Not yet a partner with Bob Rogers Ministries? Find out how you can become one today and receive special gifts and monthly messages from Dr. Bob Rogers. Plus, stay connected with the ministry with the most up-to-date preaching schedule and more. It's all new and now open at BobRogersMinistries.org.
Try to mess with the remnant, God himself will come down and put on his boxing gloves and lay you flat out, because God is God, God God is real and the word of God will prevail forever. Somebody give him praise in the house.
Evangel Presents with Dr. Bob Rogers returns live all summer long, starting July 19th at 11 a.m. with special guest Perry Stone. Tune in on WBNA 21 and on 88.5 WJIE for the live broadcast of Evangel Presents with Dr. Bob Rogers from the Evangel World Prayer Center in Louisville, Kentucky. For more information, visit bobrogersministries.org.
Trying to focus on these other people out in the audience, and I couldn't get my mind off of what I did. I see that? Was that her eye hanging on her? That couldn't be. Well, I'm going to walk back by her and just kind of, you know, not focus on her and just see if that's what I saw. Seeing how you kind of pretend you're looking, but you're not looking. So I walked back and I looked. I said, "Praise God! Oh my God, that's exactly what I saw. Praise God!" Oh my God, hallelujah. Ooh. Now I'm thinking, "Lord, what's going on?" He said, "I want you to fix that eye." I said, "Pardon me?" He's talking to me now. "I want you to fix that eye." "Thank you, Jesus." "So what do you want me to do?" "I want you to push that eye back into her head." Hallelujah. You got the, "Oh, dear Jesus." Be careful of those prayers that when you say, "Oh, Lord, I'll do whatever." I said, "How do you want me to do that?" He said, "I want you to just push it up in her head." I said, "Lord, what if, he said, "Now you know this by now. You know all this. Just get over there. Hurry up. We got work to do." So here I am now. A lot of times when you hear preachers up here, I don't know about Pastor Bob, but I know about me. Sometimes when you're trying to hear God for people, you got to find a way to stall gracefully. "Oh, everybody just put your hands in the air. Let's just talk to the Lord for a moment. Hallelujah. Come on, just connect with God just for about the next 10 seconds. You're buying time. What do you want me to do? Why do you want me to do?" "Oh, keep it going, people. Just keep it going. Keep the Lord praising the Lord. Hallelujah." Let me forget this eye story. Years ago, 1980, I was in a church. Two little kids were misbehaving on the front row. They would not stop, and the parents wouldn't correct them. So I told the whole church, "Let's stand to our feet, everybody. Let's all stand. Everybody put your hands up in the air. I want you to close your eyes and just look to the Lord for 30 seconds. They're all looking. I said, "You go. They look, kids went, "Oh." It's okay, sit down, boys, and God go, "Amen, amen." Those kids behaved the rest of the meeting. So you got to find a way to stall while the meeting, so you can hear. See, I depend on hearing more than I do anything. So I walked by, this woman, and I said, "Hey, how you doing there, sister?" She said, I'm all right. Woman of color, 86. I didn't know she was 86 at the moment. "I'm all right." One eye hanging right here. "I'm all right now." "Hey, so I'm going to come over here and just put my hands on you." "Okay, now." I grabbed that eye. It was just, squishy. I didn't feel no special anointing. I felt like I was on dangerous ground. You must have known it was the Lord speaking to you. I was faithing that it was the Lord speaking to me. And I grabbed that eyeball, and I'll never forget, and I pushed it up into her head. And she said, "What you doing? My God, what you doing?" I said, "Lady, just calm down. The Holy Ghost is here." "All right. Oh." She's making all these noises. Some people, if you're fortunate, when you pray for them, they'll bring all the Pentecostal stuff to the party. Come on. You don't have to do anything. All you have to do is pray. They bring the hat, the cake, the spoons. They bring it all.
You get off easy. Some preachers, they have to do it all themselves. They shana-na, and they shout. They got to do all the work. And the person's laying there. This lady brought everything to the party. I took my hand away, and believe me when I say this, I get to see a lot of stuff. I do. I'm a blessed man that way. I don't deserve it. I'm one of the most flawed individuals you'll ever meet. All I try to do in my life is decrease so he can increase. Because I have more sunken ships than I do boats floating. People see some of my floating boats and they say, man, you're an amazing man. It's just don't look underwater. And I pushed this eye in there and I could feel this. And she's screaming, you know. And we were in a high school auditorium outside of Baltimore. I was happy because the pastor was all excited. Come on now. Come on now. Yeah, go ahead, man of God. Go ahead. Man of God's doing this. He's up there cheering me. I was happy for that. I took my hand away, and the eye stayed in the socket. She jumped up, and she began to shout, I can see. You know what? I can see. I can see. Now, you know what she said? Here's what she began to say. I've been going everywhere. I tell you what, oh, no one would ever put my hand and shove that. Oh, I've had so many people, white and black and women and men. Oh, but oh, I felt the power today. Now, I'm not saying I'm more special than the other people. I believe they softened the ground. I believe they made a difference in making that all happen. Who knows who softens the ground and, you know, and who gets the harvest. It doesn't matter. But the point is, she kept positioning herself with her eye on her cheek, for God's sakes. Sometimes we quit so easily. Sometimes we believe a lie so quickly that nobody cares, nobody identifies. You know what? We're all in that same boat. We're all in that same boat. The Bible says, not the Bible, but history, Howard Hughes was in an airplane, one of the richest men ever lived, flying over the Lone Star State of Texas. Here's what he said to his pilot. He said, do you think anybody down there knows I'm up here? The pilot said, well, Mr. Hughes, why would they know you're up here? He said, well, you know I'm up here. He said, Mr. Hughes, I'm your pilot. Of course I know. But he said, how's come they don't know? And the pilot said that he was froze by that moment of feeling nobody knows I'm up here. Well, he forgot there was somebody besides the pilot. And today, wherever you are, whatever you've been diagnosed, whatever whatever age bracket you're in, don't resign to it. If it's one thing the Bible's full of, it's people that had things for a long time. Well, man at Bethesda, 38 years. Epileptic boy since birth. Hunched over woman, 18 years. Woman with the issue, many, many, many years. And so many times we're so quick to just resign and we forfeit the benefits of Calvary. Come on, say, he loads me daily with benefits. Come on. It's one thing to enjoy the anointing. It's another thing to let it break the yoke. If you enjoy feeling the presence of it, and you want to be slain for it, get the rest of it. Get better eyes. Get better hearing. Get a new organ created. We just had another stomach created, a lung created, kidney created. Young boy in Michigan, they come out and they said, he only has one kidney, born with one. And I said, he'll have another kidney in 3 months. And then that other kidney just popped up in there. Perfect match with the other kidney. God has miracle mail for you. Amen. Come on, say, I got miracle mail. God wants to be able to say to you, you go to Evangel World Prayer, you hear the best of the best here. Amen. That was weak. He's sitting right over here. You better. I said you hear the best of the best. Man, your expectancy should be getting sky high for anything. I mean, if you don't believe that, then quit singing All Things Are Possible. Start singing Some Things Are Possible, Only Believe. Start singing Some Things. But if you think All Things, God's looking for a few people in this hour who dares to believe that God can do the impossible, that they're not out of the sound of heaven, without beyond the reach, that something clearly distinguishable about you can be changed, that'll make you a conversation piece to your family. Legion had 6,000 demons. 6,000 demons, is a legion is 6,000. 6,000 demons couldn't keep him from coming to Jesus. Tell your neighbor, you're not that bad yet. Come on, tell your neighbor, hurry up. So you're not that bad yet. If you want something, I mean, if you really want something, don't let your cry be taken from you. Just because people quit praying, just because people quit asking you on Sunday, hey, how's your back? Sometimes we put too much expectation on people because they got their own plate. They got their own stuff. And if you just begin to realize, I can't, even though I can't get to church this week, I can't cut my cry out. Even though I can't get to that healing crusade, I'm not going to cut my cry out. I'm not out of the hospital yet, but I still can cry from a hospital bed. I can still keep my signal going vertical. Come on. We're so panicky when our cell phone gets down to ones. My God, we carry a plug with us. Come on, somebody. We got plugs all over the place. Airports have stations now to plug your phone in. Because we can't let our phone get dead. We won't have any communication. Come on, say, I have to stay plugged in. Come on. I got to keep my phone on charge. Somebody might be trying to call me. It might be somebody important. It could be my lucky day. Come on. What people will do to keep their laptops and their cell phones charged. Keep your cry. You just don't know what God has set up for you. And whenever you begin to base the cry that God's receiving from what people are receiving. People, I go to that church and nobody said anything. Well, that's because they got their own stuff. Well, the pastor should have called me. He's busy. Well, it's not the church I grew up in. Church has changed. We're trying to get people hooked on to Jesus, not people. Come on. Come on, somebody help me here today. Because it is lonely when you're suffering. And then even though people say these magic words, I know what you're going through. I know what you're going through. And while they're saying it, yeah, I'll call you at 3. Yeah, we'll have lunch. Like I said, I know what you're going through. The reason he came inside of you is that I'll never leave you. I'm with you in every storm. I haven't lost a fight yet. The devil's a 5-time loser. And I'll tell you what, he's about to be a 6-time loser because you're about to drag him all over your neighborhood. Come on. But if you buy into the feeling that nobody's hearing you, that's not when you stop praising. That's when you start to say, I'm going to keep praising. I'm going to keep standing on that scripture. I'm going to hold on to that prayer cloth. We had a girl pastor. This is an amazing story. We had a girl, young girl. She was, I'm thinking, 7 years old. She had the disease where you don't grow anymore. You can't grow. She called our office. She said, do you think I could have one of those miracle prayer cloths sent? The mother called. And yeah, we'll send one out. So we sent one out. It was a month went by or whatever. And the mother called again and she says, we got a problem. She said, would you ask Pastor Billy? She said, she hasn't left go of that cloth for over a month. She sleeps with it. It's with her all day and it stinks. It's dirty. But I can't get it out of her hands. ask Pastor Billy, if I get it out of her hands and wash it, will that disturb anything? Oh, and by the way, tell him she's grown 3 inches.
Hey! Oh, by the way!
You know what I said? Tell her to keep her hands off of that cloth. She's liable to be 5'9". She's liable to be 6 foot. Dear God, why would you tamper with that? What I'm saying is the little girl locked in. She locked in on something, and she said, I'm not leaving go of this. Your faith has got to be more than comfort. It's got to lock in. Sometimes we quit right before victory's there, and death happens. We quit right before victory's there, and then people quit because it didn't happen the way, yada, yada. Sometimes it's a journey. Sometimes you got to go through some stuff. I wish we all didn't, but sometimes we do. But while you're going through that, just understand he's with you in that process. Amen. And he hears your cry. Amen. Oh, I tell you. Oh, my. I was going through anesthesia. My last bout with cancer was 2003. I was diagnosed stage 4, my lymph system. And I was in the hospital, and they were getting ready to go in and see how invasive the cancer had gotten. 2003. This is what's that, 12 years ago. And I hadn't been under any anesthesia since I was a boy. So the nurses come in, and they're getting ready to put the IV in me, you know. And I said, okay. I said, I'm laying there in the gurney, and the nurse says, okay, we're going to just put this needle in you, and you'll begin to, you know, go to sleep. And I said, now you have the right amount, don't you? Don't you have the, right amount up there, don't you? She said, what are you talking about? I said, the right amount of anesthesia. Well, she said, yeah, I'm an anesthesiologist. I said, well, you might be that, but I said, just make sure you got the right numbers up there. She said, sir, she said, no one ever said that to me. I said, well, I'm not being mean about it. I just make sure you got the right numbers. She said, you must be a special person. I said, I am. She said, well, you know, I'll take care of you. I said, but ma'am, and the Holy Ghost spoke to me. He said, hey, big guy, hey, I got you. I got you. I'm with you. It's so easy to get out of faith. Just, it's so easy if you take your eyes off the road for a moment to be over in the berm. And then that reminds you, you've got to get back in the berm. And he said to me, I got you, I got you. She said, now you okay? I said, I'm great. It just took that one little Holy Ghost, hey, I got you. He's in everything that you're doing. And he's about to show himself strong on his being in a greater way. I believe before this year is over, this church is going to have visitation. Amen. At a level it's never seen. I believe you're going to have visitation. Come on, somebody better help me this morning here. But if you get in that frame of mind, there's another service tonight, another healing service, another guy coming in. One lady said, if there's one more guy that comes with a white jacket and white shoes, I'm just running out. Well, here I come walking in with a white jacket and white shoes. Her husband says, just try it. I'm just so tired of these guys with a white jacket and the white shoes. He said, honey, just stay put, please. She had a brace on. The lady lived in chronic pain with a brace, and she's ready to bail out. Her husband's saying, just give it a shot. White jacket. Look at the shoes. Why can't he wear dark shoes? What the? White shoes. What's the Bible say? What's that weight that so easily besets you? So what happens? I call that lady out. Ma'am. And she's thinking, oh, my God. Oh, my God. I mean, she's no more in faith than a fish lives in a tree. Come on, somebody. She comes walking up there with all kind. I didn't know there's all kind of attitudes about me. She comes walking up, and then she puts on the, you know, she puts it on. Yes. Oh, thank you, Lord. Yes. And all this stuff going on. Aren't you glad that your God can put all that to the side? Does it grieve him? Yeah. Does it stop him? No. He's full-time for you. He's full time for you. You're still sitting here today. You're about to get stronger. Amen. You're about to get healthier. Amen. You're about to get smarter. You're about to come into promotion. Don't leave go of your cry. Don't leave go of your signal. When nobody else can hear it. I mean, I have people around me all the time sending me signals. You know, I want to do what you do. I want a double portion. You know, how can I get a mantle? How can I, all around, you know, God's called me. I'm the next Oral Roberts, you know. I mean, all of these people, everywhere that I go, noise all around me. And I had to really release all that because you can't help everybody. But I had to say to them, hey, I may not hear you. I may not ever even touch you. How can you touch people in the crowds of thousands? But we have a God. Carmen sings that he sings the song. I know there's a God in heaven who still saves, delivers, and heals. And if you'll just keep that signal and not get into a bad attitude, not get grumpy on me. One lady came up from Toronto. She said, I came here for 3 months, and 3 months you didn't touch me. I stood over there one night. I'll bet you I stood over there for an hour. What did you do? You came down the line to the person right next, and you turned around and went the other way. I said, ma'am, I didn't do that knowingly. Well, I don't know why God would do that. Are you saying God did that? I said, ma'am, I'm not saying that. But you're here tonight. Why don't we try tonight? You're right here in front of me. Let's get it done right now. But I'd like to know why you did that. Ma'am, I don't know. You know, I'm trying to get her into faith. She wants to fight. I'm trying to get her better. She wants to stay bitter. She wants a reason for yesterday. I'm trying to get her into today. Get out of yesterday. Shout, that was then. This is now. Say it. That was then. Get out of yesterday. I said, ma'am, come on, right now. I said, and I didn't know what to do. So I had to pull one of these. I said, oh, my, Holy Ghost is here. She said, all right, then. All right. Just to get her to listen. Touched her, she felt, and she kept, she said, Mama, it's all gone. Mama, I love you, brother. Oh, you're special. Well, I was special when you didn't like me. I was special whenever I passed you up and didn't know I was passing you up. Your job is to come in here and know from Pastor Bob to you, from whoever's here. Perry Stone's coming to you, whoever. Richard Roberts, to you, whoever, is to get you connected vertically. To get that vertical connection. I'll close with this. It bothered me for years that it took God 400 years to bring Israel out. That bothered me in the earliest part of my ministry. I didn't have an answer for that. Because people would say, well, if he's such a great God, why would he leave them suffer 400 years. You run into those people are out there. Some of them are in your family. Come on, say amen. Amen. And you, what do you say at Thanksgiving dinner? And they go, I got a question, Brother Billy. Why'd he leave them out there 400 years? Well, you throw all kind of answers out that you know in your own heart, that don't sound right either. But if you're a pastor, they may accept it. Come on, say amen. Amen. And then one time, so I was praying, and I stopped the car. I said, Lord, you're going to help me with this. I said, I need to know why it took you so long. He said, it took them 400 years. I heard their cry right away. It took 400 years for the cry to get vertical. They weren't vertical. They were crying among themselves. They were crying within themselves. They were crying all over the place. It took 400 years before that cry went, oh, God. Vertical. All of these meetings are about to get you vertical. And boy, when you get vertical, things begin to happen. I'm not your reason that you are or you aren't. I'm just a contact person. I'm just someone saying, hey, help me, let me help you get to the person that I've met. It's all about connecting to him that you can't see. him that by faith that you believe he's here and real more than that chair you're sitting on. Catherine said to me one time as a young teenager, she said, Billy, she said, you're going to run into things that you're not going to have an answer for. I said, but Ms. Coleman, you do pretty well. She said, I don't know anything. I said, that's not true. She said, I don't know anything, and neither do you. I'm thinking, boy, that lady's, how do you use her? She's so insulting, telling me I don't know anything. She said, learn these three words, I don't know. Learn them. You're going to need these three words. And she said, it'll save you a lot of heartache. I don't know. Because all of what I do is a mystery to me. And it'll be a mystery to you. And it's truth. I see people that I don't think should get healed, they get healed right away. I see people that they deserve it yesterday and they're still struggling. I don't have those answers. So what do we say to those people? Push that reset button. Stay in the miracle line. Don't get over here in the waiting line. Get in the miracle line. And no matter how old you are, understand or what you're going through, that there's a God in heaven who hears and he's listening for a signal. I don't know what signal he wants from you. He may want something different from each one of us today. But if you'll continue to give him a signal, he can break cocaine in seconds. He can break you from stuff that other people are taking years to get broken from. Counseling sessions and rehab centers. One breath, one drop of blood. Come on, one touch of the hem. Come on, somebody. One whisper from the master. Oh, come on, somebody give God a big shout here today. Come on, somebody give him a mighty praise. But cultivate that. It's not a gift. Cultivate that. I know you hear me. I know you. Cultivate that. You know? Honor your pastor. Worship God. Honor these leaders. Double honor them. But worship him. And boy, whenever you read the Bible, you'll hear him. Whenever you praise to him, you'll hear him. He shows up in all of that. So don't let your age, your diagnosis. Tonight, 5 o'clock, we're going to be doing a lot of ministry around this altar. I believe God has something for you. Right here, this couple right here. Come to me, right here. All three of you. You got a baby there? How many is in this family? Dear God, the whole row. Get the whole row up here. You go to this church? How long have you been coming to this church? You like it? Who's the greatest pastor on the planet? Well, it's a good thing I don't have to hold a cue card up for that, right? What do you need today? Finances. What do you need today? What do you need today? What's wrong with your eyes? You have a hard time seeing? What do you mean you have a hard time seeing? You were born, you have what? Since fourth grade. So your eyes are better right now? Well, no, look. Are they better? They're the same. And you, ma'am? More of him. And you, sir? The anointing. Oh, I love yours. Who's baby? Oh, where's he at? There you are. And what do you need? Finances. Well, you all want money, don't you? You're sowing seed, aren't you? Put your hands up quickly, all over the place. We give you praise, Master. We thank you, Holy Ghost. We thank you, Holy Ghost, for healing these eyes and for bringing up the harvest. For bringing up the harvest. For bringing up the harvest. If you want God involved with your harvest, he's got to get involved with your seed. Talk to your seed. Call it forth. Water it. Seed time, wait, harvest time. There's a time in the middle there where you water, you nurture. Come back to me. Come forth. Declare first fruits to the Lord. God said he's going to bring you more than you could ever comprehend. He said he's going to do a harvest in you you've never, ever seen. You've only heard about it and read about it. But because you've done it in faith and you've been continually doing it, he's going to cause a generational blessing to pass into you and your seed line. They'll never be cursed. The power. They'll never be in lack. Oh, the power's on that girl. That power of the Holy Ghost is on this young girl. Oh, the power here of the Holy Ghost. That power of the Holy Ghost. We give him praise. And on this baby and on this mother. Oh, the power of the Holy Ghost and the anointing on this man. God, we just pray you're mighty, mighty, mighty. Yeah, you're being freed today. God said the world used to hijack your tongue, but I'm hijacking it for the gospel. And you're going to say the oracles of God. You're going to speak the oracles. Somebody give him praise today. Oh, my God. What's this?
Parkinson's.
Parkinson's? How long you had Parkinson's?
I guess about 2 years.
So where's it at?
Body, actually.
You feel it?
At times.
How about right now? No. You don't feel it. Hold your hands up. I believe in the shadow. I think if you just get near, you have faith. Is anybody with you? Your wife?
Yes.
Where's she at? Come, ma'am, quickly. I don't know what time it is. What time do we have? What's our time? 3:00
He's so tired. He's had problems with balance.
Okay.
He's taking medication for
tremors. Medication.
But it's not tremor.
Okay.
But he's being treated for tremors because he has Parkinson's.
I know what they're calling it. I know. I understand all that. See, you go to church here?
Yes.
Okay. Step over just for a minute. So you're being treated for the tremors.
That medication is for the tremors. It's for tremors and to help him with his balance and other things. I'm not sure what all.
What happens when between medication times? What happens? Does that get worse?
Very little tremor, just fatigue, dizziness.
I don't believe he has Parkinson's. No. Yeah, I don't believe that. Put your hands up.
Somebody gotta help me. I need a couple people. I need 5 people. Give me 5. Come on. Power. The power. My God! Woo! Power! Woo! Get him up! Come on! Get walking back in. Walk the whole way back there. Put your hands up again. Somebody better praise him. Thank you.
generational curses. I break it in the name of Jesus Christ. May there be a change that takes place for the glory of the Lord. In Jesus' name.
Evangel Presents with Dr. Bob Rogers returns live all summer long, starting July 19th at 11 a.m. with special guest Perry Stone. Tune in on WBNA 21 and on 88.5 WJIE for the live broadcast of Evangel Presents with Dr. Bob Rogers from the Evangel World Prayer Center in Louisville, Kentucky. For more information, visit bobrogersministries.org.
Himself will come down and put on his boxing gloves and lay you flat out, because God is God, God is real, and the word of God will prevail forever. Somebody give him praise in the house.
The all-new home for Bob Rogers Ministries is now open. Visit bobrogersministries.org. to submit prayer requests, see sermons, stay connected, and more, including the all-new Partners Only website, where partners go for even more. Not yet a partner with Bob Rogers Ministries? Find out how you can become one today and receive special gifts and monthly messages from Dr. Bob Rogers. Plus, stay connected with the ministry with the most up-to-date preaching schedule and more. It's all new and now open at bobrogersministries.org.
The Bible says, be ye not unwise, but understanding. Understand what the will of the Lord is. If we will seek Him, God will show us how to be blessed. God will break off of us whatever the devil has put on us, in Jesus' name. Ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. There's power in us to bring healing and miracles and signs and wonders in the name of Jesus. Nothing shall be impossible to us. Nothing shall be withheld from us, because we are walking uprightly before the Lord. I break generational curses. I break it in the name of Jesus Christ. May there be a change that takes place for the glory of the Lord. In Jesus' name.